Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents At Any Cost by Andrea Kane, narrated by Hilary Huber. Prologue. Brightington University, Birchmont, Westchester County, New York, 8 years ago. A kill for a kill. Weeks of watching and waiting, plans devised, soon to be meticulously executed. Mid-November, football season nearing its peak, Thursday night, 9 p.m., campus in early weekend party mode, undergrads drinking, smoking up at the frat houses, athletic building deserted, nearly deserted. His target was there, alone. Thursday night was his late night during football season. That's when he reviewed his game strategy and player weaknesses. That's when he targeted the next eager kid to torture until he broke. The bastard wouldn't be breaking anyone ever again. Not the way he'd broken Hank. As the star quarterback in high school, Hank had gotten a full-ride Division I scholarship. Since he'd come from a dirt-poor family, this was the opportunity of a lifetime. A first-rate college education with a shot at the NFL. It was supposed to be a life-changing event. Instead, it turned out to be a death sentence. His executioner had been Pete Rice. Football coach? Bullshit. Rice hadn't coached Hank. He'd tortured him, driven him, until he'd blown out his knee on a rain-soaked football field junior year, ending his college career, his dreams, and in the end, his life. It was first down and goal. Rice was about to find out the true meaning of payback. The campus grounds were soggy. Leftover patches of wet leaves and an endless span of slick grass made worse by the cold, steady rainfall. The bare trees swayed as rain pounded their branches. A wet mess. Treacherous. Like a wet football field. Slugging through the debris, he approached the athletic building, pausing yards away to don the black ski mask. He then tugged his hood back into place. No point in taking chances. Security cameras were everywhere. He didn't need his face to be captured. Other than the mask, he could be any college student. A waterproof parka that swallowed up his body, jeans and combat boots, standard college garb. He reached the building and slid Hank's ID card into the entry slot. The card still worked, too soon for it to be deactivated. He was in. He wriggled into his latex gloves. The office door was unlocked. Rice was at his desk, files spread across it. He was scribbling something on one of them, brows knit in concentration, totally focused on his work, clueless that he was about to die. In one fluid motion, he was inside the office, the door closed behind him. Rice leapt to his feet, snatching the heavy football trophy on his desk as he rounded the front of it to defend himself against the intruder. Without a word, the killer whipped out a pistol and fired two bullets, one into each of Rice's kneecaps. Rice howled, collapsing to the floor in pain. The trophy hit the floor beside him with a thud. The assailant moved quickly, four long strides until he was behind Rice, dragging him back to his chair and heaving him into it. He shoved a rag in the coach's mouth to stifle his screams, then moved behind him, wrapping a strong arm in a chokehold around Rice's throat. He pocketed his pistol, pulled out a zip tie, and leaned down to cinch the writhing man's ankles together. That done, he slapped a digital voice recorder on the desk with the record feature on. He yanked the rag out of Rice's mouth, tossed it aside, and anchored his forearm against the left side of the coach's neck, using his free hand to pull as tight against the carotid artery as he chose to. For now. A rush of power surged through him. He could taste victory. But there was work to do before the final play. "You killed Hank Bishop," he growled. "I want details." When he got no answer, only a violent trembling of Rice's body, he tightened the pressure around his neck. "Talk." "Car crash," the coach gasped. "I didn't." "Wrong answer." His grip tightened still more, enough so Rice was on the verge of losing consciousness. The coach struggled in vain, his attempts weak and fading. His soon-to-be executioner eased the pressure the tiniest fraction. He knew just what it would take, and he wasn't ready. Not until he got what he wanted. "Wanna die?" he asked in a flat tone that was chillingly devoid of emotion. Terrified, blood oozing down his legs, Rice gave a feeble shake of his head. "Good, because this is what it will feel like." He increased the pressure until Rice passed out. Slowly, he eased the chokehold until the scumbag came to. "Now I'll ask my question again," he said calmly. "Why is Hank dead? Why was he in that car crash? This is your last chance. I want to hear it all. What you did, how you did it, what you drove him to." Rice was drenched in sweat, his entire body shuddering, choking sounds coming from his throat. No further coercion was necessary. Between gasps for air, the coach spilled his guts, revealing everything he'd done, everything that had happened, plus a whole lot more that was happening still. Interesting stuff, some of which he knew about, still more of which he didn't. It was even bigger than what he'd come here to learn, but frankly, he didn't give a shit. He'd originally planned to take the voice recorder with him to relive Rice's agonized confession whenever he chose to. But it really didn't matter. He'd committed the bastard's words to memory. So instead, he'd leave the recorder here, let the cops hear the entire confession, including the big picture part that had nothing to do with Hank, but that would send their investigation in the entirely wrong direction, a direction his employer wouldn't appreciate. But that was his problem. His adrenaline pumping, he tightened his chokehold into a death grip, pressing against the carotid artery, closing it off, and squeezing the life out of his victim. A minute later, Rice was dead. Luca Flores had been a security guard at Brighton University for a decade. The pay was shit. His other job paid a whole lot better. So when his boss instructed Flores to keep an eye on Pete Rice, he didn't ask questions. He just complied, which meant he had a bird's-eye view of the masked guy who slipped outside the athletic building, glancing quickly around before pulling off his mask and disappearing into the night. Flores pressed himself back into the wet bushes, waiting and watching until the guy was gone. Then he went inside the athletic building to take a look. 5 minutes later, he bolted out of the building, stuffing one item under his coat and another in his pocket. He glanced furtively around to make sure no one was nearby and then ducked back into the bushes to make his call. "I need to see you, now," he said with rising hysteria. The urgency was clear. No further clarification was necessary. "The usual spot," was the reply. "I'm on my way." Flores weaved in and out of traffic, making the drive to Bayonne, New Jersey in record time. He turned into the broken-down side street where these meetings took place and waited for the man parked in front of him to leave his car and join Flores in his. A moment later, his boss was in the passenger seat, shutting the door behind him and turning to Flores. "What happened?" "Rice is dead." Flores didn't mince words. "Strangled. There were choke marks all over his neck. There was blood on the floor and the smell of gunpowder, so I'm sure there was more that went on before he was finished off." A hint of a pause.
"Did you see the killer?"
"Yeah, on his way out." Sweat was pouring down Flores's back, and he raked both shaking hands through his hair. He'd never seen a murder victim in his life, nor had he ever had a desire to see one. "He was wearing a mask, but he took it off when he left the building."
"Recognize him?"
"I think so. Yes."
"What does that mean?"
"It means that if it's the guy I'm thinking of, I'm not sure if he actually goes to Brighton or just visits, but he's in the stands at almost every one of the school's football games, and he hung out with the star quarterback. They seemed really tight." "That poor kid, the quarterback, tore up his knee and couldn't play anymore. 3 weeks ago, he was killed in a car crash."
"Which his close friend might blame on the coach for whatever reason. That would make sense. Revenge is a powerful motivator."
"That's what I figured."
Flores still felt like he was going to puke. So I rifled through Rice's files until I found the one belonging to the dead kid, just in case you needed it. Also, there was a voice recorder on Rice's desk. Looks like he was talking when he died. So I grabbed that too.
Did you listen to it?
Hell no. I got out of there as fast as I could, called you, and drove here.
Flores reached around back and snatched up the file and the digital recorder from the floor of the back seat.
Here.
He practically shoved them at his boss. The other man took the proffered items.
Did anyone see you?
He asked.
No, and the area is deserted because all the kids are in party mode, mostly on the frat quad, but I'd better get back.
A nod.
Do that. And Flores, I'll take it from here. You forget this entire thing ever happened.
It's forgotten.
It was the most grateful, if impossible, promise Flores had ever made.
Good.
As he spoke, the man reached into his pocket and pulled out a wad of bills, folding them in half and handing them to the security guard.
Nice work.
Flores took the money on autopilot. He hadn't been sure what to expect, but this was sure as hell the best possible outcome. Freaked out or not, it felt good to be appreciated for something, and to be compensated for it.
Thanks, he said.
He waited for his boss to head back to his own car before counting his bonus. 10 $100 bills. $1,000. Double what he made in a week at the university.
Maybe finding a dead body wasn't so bad after all.
The other man slid behind the wheel of his sedan and slammed the door shut. This wasn't supposed to be the night, but the loose cannon had decided otherwise. Damn him. He turned on the voice recorder and listened to the entire confession. Ironic, Flores had saved his own life by not doing the same. He made a quick mental calculation. It had been too long since the murder had taken place. Time wasn't on his side. Much as he disliked using the phone, even one as heavily encrypted as his, he'd have to make an exception. This needed to be taken care of ASAP. He made the necessary call. A voice answered on the first ring.
Yeah?
I need the sanitation crew for a black bag job, he said. Athletic building at Brighton University. Second floor. Pete Rice. Send a cleaner. And some longshoremen to take care of his car. A silver Lexus SUV parked outside in the lot. And I'd make sure the vehicle takes a long voyage to our friends overseas.
The deceased's office. 10 days later. Two local police detectives stood inside Pete Rice's office, arms folded across their chests as they dubiously eyeballed the young woman their chief had summoned to assist in the investigation. They didn't like the fact that she was here, and they made no attempt to disguise it. However, a week and a half had passed since Coach Rice had vanished, and the investigation had hit a brick wall. The university's bigwigs, together with the parents who paid their kids' tuitions, the alumni who cherished their football games, the whole college community and beyond, were up in arms. They were demanding answers, now. And the cops had nothing to give them, although not for lack of trying. Despite an extensive search, no body had been found. The coach's car, which had been missing from the parking lot, had yet to be recovered. Even in pieces. Other than the lingering smell of gunpowder and the small blood samples that crime scene had collected, bagged, and ultimately DNA matched to Rice, the coach's office was devoid of evidence, and there was nothing personal about the coach himself. The police hadn't stopped there. They'd thoroughly searched Rice's apartment. No signs of burglary, nothing amiss, no indications of a man who had fled. Rice was single with no kids, but his neighbors had all been questioned, as had any other persons of interest. Not a shred of useful information had been uncovered. Pete Rice had been a campus legend, a hardcore win-at-all-costs coach, a hero. What he lacked in compassion, he made up for in skill. He was both hated and respected, feared yet sought after by his players. The detectives had interviewed enough of his players, both past and present, to pick up on the undercurrents. But hating someone and doing them bodily harm were two entirely different things.
How much bodily harm? At least some, given the blood spatter and the residual smell of gunpowder. But more than that? No one knew. Certainly not the poor, terrified custodian who'd come in the morning after the incident to do his job and clean the coach's office, only to walk into a frightful scene. The lack of physical evidence caused the pressure from the community to reach a fevered pitch. Which is why the chief of police had called in Claire Hedgley, quietly and with minimal media exposure.
"How long is this going to take?"
one of the detectives asked her. "I don't know," was her honest reply. "But I'll do my best."
"Yeah, do that."
Ignoring the sarcasm, Claire tied back her long blonde hair in a ponytail, freeing up her field of view. She'd learned to ignore the barbs and the scrutiny. She was used to it. The truth was that no police force wanted to openly admit that they worked with psychics, even if Claire never billed herself as one. She explained time and time again that she was what was known as a claircognizant, someone who intuitively knew things, not someone who had a bona fide spiritual connections to the past or the future. The distinction never made a difference. To the authorities, what she did wasn't science, therefore it wasn't regarded. Still, more than a few Westchester County Police Departments had elicited Claire's help, and she'd proven her abilities time and again over the past 3 years, ever since her junior year in college when she'd been an integral part of solving a missing student crime at her own alma mater. Word spread. Credibility was established, and Claire's consultations with law enforcement increased, under the radar but with a high success rate. Now she concentrated on the task at hand, starting with a brief perusal of Rice's office. Barren. Metal file cabinets, a worn desk and chair, and a basic desktop computer and printer. Papers and file folders strewn about. Trophies on a shelf and a heavy one on his desk. Team photos on the wall. No personal touches, like family photos or indications of hobbies. Just exhibitions of the Brightington football team. With slow, deep breaths, Claire shut her eyes and channeled her energy. Nothing immediate. Then again, her insights came at their will, not hers. All she could do to help them along was to open her mind and let the energy flow. The old-fashioned clock on the wall ticked away the minutes, long minutes. And suddenly, nothing became something. Claire's eyes flew open, and her gaze settled on the missing coach's desk, a dark feeling of evil pervading her. She stepped forward and pressed her palms firmly against the metal surface of the desk. Currents of death coursed through her. Not just death, murder. She leaned forward and wrapped her fingers around the heavy football trophy that was planted on Rice's desk, something he frequently touched and always treasured. Something that would bring Claire closer to her insights. Something that had been moved from the floor to the desk. Something the coach had been handling when fear had crept up his spine. Something he'd planned to use as a weapon. Filaments of awareness, fragments of certainty, vengeance thoroughly planned and executed, death painful and sustained, and a killer with a very sick, twisted mind. 1. Kenna B.D., Elmton, New York, present day. Amy Bregman left her office and hopped into her car, ready for the adventure du jour. She loved her job. When she was hired to be chief marketing officer of Kenna B.D., she felt as if she'd won the lottery. She'd never thought that being a party girl in college would be an asset in her job hunting, although frat parties or not, she'd worked hard to earn her MBA in marketing. Still, this was a dream come true. She was being paid to take this exciting startup beverage company and grow it into a household name. She'd already made great strides in getting the buzz going. Kenna BD, which boasted a unique line of CBD-infused beer, was the brainchild of Nick Colotti, a brilliant engineering grad student at Danforth University, Amy's own alma mater. Nick had developed their core product through a combination of skill and luck. He was playing around in the university lab, trying to extract CBD oil from cannabis using supercritical CO2 and infusing it into a keg of beer for a frat house party he was throwing. The results were nothing short of spectacular, and CannaBD was born. Nick, who Amy had met at Danforth when she was still an undergrad, had hired her shortly after she'd gotten her MBA and he'd firmly launched the company, a launch made possible through the capital that his father had invested in his business. And Amy had jumped in with both feet, ready to effectively market the product line. Given the young demographic they were appealing to, Amy joked that she was lucky enough to attend college all over again. She spent most of her time in and around colleges, meeting and talking with recent alumni, grad students, and current 21-plus undergrads. She was smart enough to know that the largest consumption of alcoholic beverages was tied to Greek life events, so she focused her efforts on schools with a large number of established and thriving fraternity and sorority chapters, all with active current and alumni members. And she worked very hard to build relationships with the student officers, members, faculty advisors, and alumni directors of those schools. She didn't stop there. In order to drive word of mouth, she recruited young influencers in the alcoholic beverage space. Not only officers, members, and young alumni of college fraternities and sororities, but also socially active, attractive young people attending these colleges who knew how to showcase a highly spirited, coveted lifestyle via YouTube videos, Instagram, and Snapchat. She organized frequent product tastings right on campuses, which gave her yet another opportunity to chat with her target audience. All in all, things were going great. Until, abruptly, they weren't. Danforth University, Office of the Director of Alumni Relations, Manhattan, New York. Rita Edwell sat at her desk, staring at the printed sheet of paper in her hand, reading and rereading the factually imparted information. She didn't cry. The time for crying was over. She'd sobbed and sobbed when she got the initial diagnosis. This second opinion was a pie-in-the-sky attempt to mitigate the finality of her prognosis, a filament of hope that there could be some unknown treatment that could lengthen her life. There wasn't. The cancer was too advanced. It had metastasized and was running rampant through all her organs. And this impersonal piece of paper in her hand slammed the door on her hopes. She closed her eyes, numbly reflecting on the fact that she'd never see her 40th birthday, that she'd never compile a bucket list, much less cross things off one, that she'd made such a mess of her life, a mess she'd been desperate to undo. It was too late. A year from now, at most, she wouldn't be here. And there was no way to clean things up by then, much less undo all the ugly things she'd done. All the material things that had mattered so much, her impeccable suede suit, her Louis Vuitton bag, now seemed meaningless and immorally obtained. Her office phone rang, and she opened her eyes, staring blankly at the piece of equipment as if seeing it for the first time. She had to shake off this fog, to be in the present as long as she could. She pressed the flashing button that was labeled with her secretary's name. Yes, Marie?
Ms. Edwell, Amy Bregman is here for her 11 o'clock meeting, her secretary announced.
Rita blinked. Amy. Yes, she'd made this appointment last week, when she'd still been hanging in medical limbo. She'd wanted to help her favorite protege then, and she wanted to help her even more now. Maybe she could do a few good, decent things before she passed.
Thank you, Marie, she replied, stuffing the sheet of paper in her desk drawer. Tell Miss Bregman to come right in.
A moment later, the door opened, and Amy's bright, smiling face greeted her. Rita, hi! She hurried in, shutting the door behind her. Hi yourself. Rita couldn't help smiling back. Amy had a natural, artless charm that drew people to her like flies to honey. It would serve her well in her new job,
Just as it had made Rita notice her from the first, when Rita was working in the admissions office at Danforth and was representing the university at a college fair Amy attended. Amy had sought her out, asked a dozen questions in a way that had somehow not been annoying. Still, delightful or not, it had been clear that Amy was motivated and determined to get into Danforth's challenging undergraduate school and to move up to its even more rigorous graduate business school to earn her MBA. Rita had found herself eager to make that dream a reality. She'd become Amy's point person in the admissions office, corresponding with her via email as Amy worked through the applications process. She'd advocated for her when decision-making time came for potential matriculating freshmen, and she'd gone on to advise Amy after she officially enrolled, as well as after Rita moved up to become the university's dean of undergraduate students. Now, after transferring to the Office of Alumni Relations and rising quickly through its ranks to become director, she was in a unique position to continue advising and assisting Amy at this point in the business world that Amy had just stepped into. So when Amy had asked for this meeting, Rita had been more than happy to agree. She rose, reaching across her desk to give Amy a quick hug. "It's wonderful to see you." She gestured for her protege to sit. "You too." The smile faded a bit from Amy's face. "You look tired. Am I coming at a bad time?" "It's never a bad time to see you," Rita assured her. "You're one of the few people who always brighten my day. Now," she brought the conversation quickly to safe territory. "You said you needed an intro to a particular alum who'd be able to help grow sales for CannabD. Who?"
"Chris Marr."
Rita felt her own smile grow cold. That was not the answer she'd been hoping for, although Lord knows it was the answer she'd feared. Chris's father, Daniel Marr, was a household name, a longtime action movie star whose earlier movies continued to be fan favorites a generation later, and who was still getting roles even in his late 50s. Chris had inherited his father's good looks and charisma. Plus, he was smart. Shrewd and smart. After graduation, he'd gotten a job at a New York steakhouse and worked his way swiftly up the ladder to become assistant manager, a job he no longer needed and had quit without a backward glance once the social media brand he'd created and launched back in college exploded into a major moneymaker. Snacks for Sports shared new ideas for what to eat while watching sporting events at home, including Chris's famous and innovative Super Bowl bites. The number of hits he got on YouTube and Instagram were multiplying by the droves, and he was now an influencer with over 1 million followers. Those followers included an enormous number of millennials and even Gen Zers in their early 20s who fell into the same demographic as potential CannabD customers. Booze and bites. It was an ideal match. It was also a fiasco for Rita. Chris was trouble, big trouble, on so many levels, and she had to be super careful about which levels she revealed to Amy.
"Rita?"
Still lost in thought, Rita started when Amy said her name.
"What's the matter?"
Amy was visibly puzzled.
"I thought you'd think it was a great idea. If Chris would agree to market CannabD side by side with his Snacks for Sports, we'd reach a gazillion people. The fit is perfect."
"You're right, it is," Rita had to admit. "At least the products are. But the personality fit is another story entirely."
"What do you mean?"
Rita went for a truth that steered clear of the bigger, more dangerous one, a truth that Amy could never know. "Chris isn't someone I'd be thrilled to have you team up with. He's reputedly into some questionable things."
"Such as?"
"Drugs, for one," she replied, unsurprised that Amy was unaware of that fact. Chris was great about keeping his nasty habits under the radar. Well, Rita sure as hell knew about them, and there was no way she was sugarcoating this. "Rumor has it he's heavily into hardcore recreational drugs, coke, ecstasy, and meth,
raging while under the influence, then driving recklessly and coming this close to wrapping his car around a tree too many times to count.
Oh,
Amy frowned.
I had no idea.
There's more, Rita pressed on,
desperately trying to talk Amy out of taking this avenue.
Chris allegedly had some ugly physical altercations with two of his previous girlfriends. No charges were ever filed, but a few people claimed to have witnessed the incidents. Not exactly a shining spokesperson for your company. Amy considered all that for a moment, and then, despite being visibly conflicted, she opted for a sound business decision that was based in fact, not supposition.
I see your point. Except that nothing you just told me is more than a rumor, which isn't a surprise, given the way celebrity gossip works. Clearly, Chris's followers aren't buying into it. His numbers are sky high, and my market research says the Canna BD's audience are avid followers. He's got it all. Good looks, charm, and an uber-famous father. At least if I have a meeting, I'll have the ability to judge for myself.
The sad part was that Rita couldn't argue with Amy's logic.
Nick is counting on me, Amy continued. He was totally psyched when I told him I was seeing you about connecting me with Chris. Canna BD is his baby. He's determined to make it a raging success, and getting Chris on board would be a big leap toward that goal. Nick is willing to give him a top-tier influencer deal.
Amy leaned forward in earnest.
Rita, I want to be the best marketing director I can be. I have to try to make this happen. It doesn't mean I condone any of the alleged activities you just ran by me, but given that no charges were ever filed and that I've seen no mention of these incidents anywhere, I have to assume that this is all just unsubstantiated gossip. And if Chris would push our product, he could open up doors that we, as a fledgling company, could never reach on our own. I have to ask. Do you think you could convince him to meet with me?
Rita was up against a wall, and she knew it. She had no good reason to refuse Amy's request. As for Chris, yeah, he'd get a real charge out of promoting a cool product like Canna BD Beer. Not to mention the charge he'd get from being approached by a pretty girl who fed into his overinflated ego and the urgency her brand new company felt over having his endorsement. There was no way Rita could say no. All she could do was to make sure Amy learned nothing dangerous from this meeting. Chris already suspected too much. Hell, he'd been part of too much. To add more fuel to the fire, he'd been in her office when she got one of those phone calls. She'd quickly postponed the conversation without mentioning names or specifics. Still, she had no idea how much, if anything, he'd pieced together. But she couldn't take a chance. She had to manage this meeting. I tell you what, she said to Amy. Let's compromise. I'll reach out to Chris. If he agrees to meet with you, it'll be the three of us, rather than just you and him. Okay? Amy grinned.
You'd act as a kind of facilitator?
Something like that, yes. A shrug.
It works for me. Anything that will give me the chance to make my pitch.
Done. Rita rose from behind her desk. Give me a day or two. I'll do my best to make this happen. Fielding's Bar, Midtown Manhattan, New York, 2 days later. Chris leaned back on his bar stool, bent one long leg at the knee, and crossed it over the other. The bar was light on traffic and filled with more 30-plus professionals in business attire than a young crowd in their 20s. Way too tame for his tastes, but he'd agreed to meet here anyway. He could have given Rita Edwell a hard time, but he was too intrigued to bother. Truth was, he was looking forward to this business pitch. It was hard to keep the grin off his face as he watched Amy Bregman play with her drink, gazing at him like he was some kind of superstar. Oh, he'd seen that look on many, many wistful faces, but it never got old, and it never stopped pumping his blood. Rita Edwell was the only downer at the table. She was supervising them like a fucking chaperone at a high school dance. It irked him, but it wasn't about to stand in his way. He angled his body toward Amy,
pointedly ignoring the university administrator. "I've actually heard of Cannabis D," he said. "I remember reading about Nick Colati's invention in the alumni news. Pretty brilliant on his part."
Amy jumped on that positive reaction. "Nick is a genius, and Cannabis D is a goldmine waiting to happen. We just need widespread awareness of our brand and our launch products, the initial line of Cannabis D beer. If we get that, the beer will sell itself, which brings me to a partnership with Snacks for Sports."
Chris chuckled. He liked this girl. She was less worldly than his usual type. Still, she was only a couple of years younger than he was. She was pretty, with just the right amount of makeup and trendy clothes to make her hot. And, the biggest turn-on of all, she had balls. "Cutting right to the chase, huh?" he asked in a half-teasing, half-seductive voice. Amy didn't avert her gaze.
"There's no point in pretending I don't have an agenda. Rita told you why I wanted this meeting. I'm hoping that the reason you're here is that you're interested in forming a business relationship with Cannabis D. It would mean a top-tier influencer deal, and I truly believe that this would double your following."
"Only doubling?" Chris was really enjoying this banter. Or he would be if Rita weren't glaring at him.
"Fine, maybe more." Amy was visibly trying to figure out if she had him hooked. She sucked at hiding her thoughts. Then again, he read women's minds only too well, and this one was in way over her head with him. He wondered what she'd be like in bed.
"That's a pretty lofty goal," he said. "Do you have marketing data to support that claim?"
Amy reached for her portfolio. "I have quite a bit of marketing data to share with you, and while I can't promise exact numbers,
I believe you."
Chris leaned forward and stilled her hand, gently pushing aside her portfolio. Subtly, he lowered his own hand beneath the table and gently caressed her thigh just beneath the hem of her dress.
"I can already see the perks involved here."
"Cut it, Chris."
Rita's words dumped a bucket of cold water on his intentions. She slammed her glass of sparkling water on the table and leaned forward, getting into his face before he could fully gauge Amy's reaction. While she hadn't yet shoved his fingers away, Amy had frozen on her bar stool and was staring at him in stunned disbelief.
"This is why I was against this meeting," Rita said, her eyes blazing. "Your behavior, as always, is appalling. And this incident, I didn't just hear about, I witnessed it myself. Or did you think I missed your oh-so-subtle leg fondling?"
Chris was spitting bullets. "What I think is that you shouldn't be here to begin with," he snapped, jerking his head around to stare Rita down. "Amy is a grown woman. She doesn't need a chaperone."
"This isn't a date," Amy found her voice, her tone rife with anger. Simultaneously, she gripped his wrist and shoved his hand off of her thigh.
It was a business meeting. I don't care who you are. It doesn't entitle you to act like a prick."
Chris's fingers clamped down on her wrist. "Who the hell do you think you're talking to, little girl? With one video, I could run your pathetic company into the ground."
"But you won't," Rita refuted furiously. "I think you've forgotten who made you, and it wasn't your daddy. I can unmake you like this."
She snapped her fingers in his face. "So get your hands off of Amy and get the hell out of here."
"Don't threaten me,"
Chris ground out between clenched teeth. He was literally vibrating with rage.
"And don't even think of fucking with my life. I don't owe you shit. In fact, given what I know, I own you. Push me and you'll find out just what I'm capable of."
He pivoted to Amy, his fingers tightening around her wrist.
"If I were you, I'd forget this meeting ever happened. Don't even let the words sexual harassment come to mind, and don't remember a word of what was said. Otherwise, it'll be more than your new company you'll be worrying about."
With that, he jumped off his stool and strode out of the bar.
Amy exhaled sharply as she watched Chris go, her heart pounding with fury and trepidation. Boy,
Am I gullible and inexperienced? She said. One of the deficits of being raised in a small town and not moving to New York City until late in high school. I'm not exactly worldly. I've been in relationships before, but nothing much.
Until now, and until Travis, Rita said, referring to Amy's new boyfriend, who Amy had happily mentioned the last time she and Rita had spoken.
Yes, until Travis, Amy agreed. But I've never come up against an egocentric bully like Chris.
A pause.
But he's not just a bully. He's abused women, you said. Rita, do you think he'd follow through on those threats he made to us?
To Amy's dismay, Rita's shoulders lifted, then fell. Honestly, I don't know. I opened all the right doors for Chris when he got started. Had I known then what I know now, I wouldn't have. He's a loose cannon. Just to be on the safe side, I'd stick close to your friends for a while. Don't go out alone. And don't mention Chris's threats to anyone. When you go back to Nick, just tell them what a jerk Chris is, that he came on to you and that he ridiculed Canopy D. That'll be enough to end any thoughts of a business alliance.
Okay, Amy said with a nod. But what about you? He looked pretty damn scary when he told you what he'd do if you pushed him. You'd better steer clear of him, too.
I plan to. Rita paused, took a deep swallow of her sparkling water as if it were hard liquor. Then she set down her glass and met Amy's gaze. Amy, I need to talk to you about something. I've put it off, but I'd rather tell you this when I'm still okay enough to be myself.
Is this about whatever it is Chris meant when he said he owns you?
Rita waved that away. I don't know what the hell Chris was talking about. He doesn't know anything about my personal life, but it's important to me that you do.
All right.
Amy felt a wave of unease. Whatever Rita was about to tell her, it wasn't good. The reason I'm so concerned about you toughening up a bit is that I won't be here to guide you for much longer. Rita swallowed hard, but she didn't weep.
Are you transferring to another university?
Amy knew in her heart that she was grasping at straws, but her heart was screaming a denial to what she was about to hear. No, Amy, I'm not transferring. I'm dying. I have stage 4 cancer. No treatment is possible. It's too far gone now to arrest. I have maybe a year to live, maybe less if the cancer continues to spread at this rate. Rita swallowed hard. I'm sorry to dump this on you, but I need to make sure you toughen up before I'm gone. Your family is far away. I know you're in a new relationship, but you don't know yet where it's going. And even if it turns out to be something solid, you still have to be self-sufficient. The world isn't always a wonderful place. I need to teach you that before it's too late. Tears were streaming down Amy's cheeks.
Oh, God, Rita.
She took her mentor's hands in hers.
How long have you known? Why didn't you tell me? And why are you worrying about me when the only thing that matters here is you?
Rita's fingers trembled, and she tightened her grip on Amy's hands. I suppose I was hoping for a miracle. Then I'd never have to tell you anything. But that miracle isn't happening, and I'm determined to help you for as long as I'm able.
How can I help you?
Amy asked through her tears. By listening to me. By not letting situations like this one happen again. By losing some of that naivete of yours, no matter how endearing it is. It leaves you wide open for predators like Chris, and even for people who are going to try to screw you over in business. Please, promise me you'll try. Amy nodded slowly.
All right, I'll try. If it means spending more time with you while I can, I'll do anything. But Rita, I meant what I said. I want to be there for you. Please, anything you need, just ask.
Rita returned to her office, depleted and still fuming. She'd had it. She was done. Done with creating animals like Chris Marr. Done with doing the wrong things for the wrong reasons. Done with it all.
At that moment, her burner phone rang. She didn't need to glance at the number. She just pressed the answer button. "Whatever it is, don't bother," she said. "I'm not living this way anymore. I'm opting out of our agreement." She ignored the threatening voice at the other end of the line. "You're wrong. I can, and I am resigning," she replied. "I'm no longer afraid of you." "Why not?" "Because I'm dying, so I'm tying up loose ends, and you're one of them. What's more, if you make my walking away difficult, I'll tell the right things to the right people before I'm gone, and you'll be out of business and in jail where you belong. So leave me alone. Don't call me again."
2. Offices of Forensic Instincts, Tribeca, New York. 2 days later, 8:45 a.m. Casey Woods rolled her eyes in annoyance as she wove her way through the lingering yet persistent media hounds still hovering outside the Forensic Instincts brownstone. As president of FI, she'd answered enough questions about the case her team had just helped solve, a priceless Irish treasure that they'd discovered and assisted in restoring to its rightful place in the National Museum of Ireland. The official report had given full credit to the NYPD and the FBI, but FI's involvement and their near miss with death had somehow leaked out, and the press was ever eager to hear the details of how Casey's renowned investigative company had factored into the dangerous and turbulent resolution. She'd said as little as possible, once again stressing that it was law enforcement who deserved everyone's gratitude. But the reporters, historians, and bloggers weren't buying it. Forensic Instincts was too well known for its reputation in solving high-profile cases, using methods that were somewhat unorthodox but always successful. Plus, their composite of team members was just too intriguing for the outside world to ignore. Casey herself, a behaviorist, and her hires, two retired FBI agents, a technology genius, a claircognizant, a former pickpocket, and a former FBI human scent evidence dog. The notoriety Forensic Instincts had acquired had never been part of Casey's vision when she started the firm, but it sure as hell was part of it now. Shielding the Hirsch pad that would gain her entry so as to avoid prying eyes, Casey punched in the code, pushed open the front door, and eased herself inside. She shut the automatically locking door behind her and leaned back against it, letting out an audible sigh. "Damn it," she muttered. "Are they still out there?" Mark Devereaux strolled down from his third floor office to greet her. Mark had been with Casey from the beginning. He was former Navy SEAL, former FBI special agent, former FBI behavioral analysis unit, and always Casey's right hand. "They've thinned out, but it's getting to be a real pain in the ass," Casey informed him, shrugging out of her jacket. "It was easier when I lived here at the brownstone. Now I have to dodge this persistent stuff just like the rest of you. Whoever said that being president was an enviable job?" Mark chuckled. "People who aren't president. Plus, it's one of the downsides for you about moving into your own place with Hutch. Now you have to be accosted outside the front door like the rest of us." Casey nodded in frustration. She and FBI Supervisory Special Agent Kyle "Hutch" Hutchinson had just taken the significant step of moving into their own apartment in Battery Park City, after being a serious couple for several years. Until then, Casey had lived alone in her fourth-floor apartment at Forensic Instincts, an apartment she now used as a go-to location when she and the team were working on something that crossed a line Hutch found untenable. It was the deal they had struck when they moved in together. Despite his love for Casey, Hutch towed the line. Casey and Forensic Instincts did not. So the best solution was for Hutch to remain in the dark about the questionable elements of FI's cases. Still, more than once, he'd found himself walking a tightrope to keep Casey safe. Regardless, they were determined to make their relationship work. Thus, the new living arrangements and the new hassles Casey had to deal with when it came to avoiding the press. With a sigh, Casey turned away from the coat rack. Simultaneously, she heard the rapid sound of padding canine paws, and a moment later, her bloodhound Hero appeared in the entranceway to greet her. Casey squatted so he could lick her face.
I missed you too, boy, she said with a grin.
Sure you did.
The sarcastic comment came from Ryan McKay, the team's way too good-looking for his own good tech whiz, as he came up from the basement level that was officially labeled his lair.
You and Hutch can thank me for your first night alone. Hero slept at my place, and he took up 3/4 of my bed.
Leaving no room for Claire, Casey teased, referring to Claire Hedgley, the team's claircognizant, who was Ryan's girlfriend, a term that she and Ryan had only recently ascribed to their all-too-obvious relationship. I get it. Thanks for my date night. I owe you one.
Claire had some late-night yoga thing, so I wouldn't have seen her anyway, Ryan responded. But you still owe me one. Hero snores, I got zero sleep, so he might be cheerful, but I'm not.
For the second time that morning, Casey rolled her eyes. Yes, Ryan, we all know how you get when you're sleep-deprived. Fine, how about if I spring for a nice dinner out for you and Claire? That piqued Ryan's interest and his brows rose.
How nice.
Your choice of restaurants.
Done. Consider us even.
Casey rose, running a hand through her shoulder-length red hair. Who's here besides us? Mark tipped his head toward the staircase.
Patrick drove in early to beat the traffic and the media hounds. He's in the kitchen grabbing something to eat.
Patrick Lynch, retired FBI and now FI's head of security, was also the most grounded member of the team, the one who kept them from pushing the boundaries too far.
Emma's been monitoring voicemails since she walked in.
Mark continued, referring to the newest member of the team, a one-time street kid whose oh-so-innocent Alice in Wonderland looks contributed to her success as a former pickpocket. That same cunning mind and those deft fingers made her an invaluable member of the team.
So far, the messages have been all bullshit. No new and exciting cases. Claire is having breakfast with Fiona,
Ryan said, referring to his younger sister and FI's most recent client. Fiona had been the target in a killer's hunt for the now-restored Irish treasure. Her skill as a goldsmith and jewelry designer, together with her deep interest in McKay family heirlooms, had made her walking prey. During the investigation, she'd developed a deep bond of friendship with the FI team, particularly with Claire. And not only because they both cared for Ryan, but because they just connected. Ryan glanced at his Apple Watch.
They met at Tribeca's kitchen at 7:30. They'll be wrapping up soon. After that, we'll have a full house.
Casey had no chance to respond before Emma came flying out of the reception alcove.
Hi, Casey.
She didn't wait for a response, just plunged right on in her usual exuberant way.
We got one repeat caller, Amy Bregman. She sounds legit and scared to death. She said it was urgent and that her life is in danger.
Casey arched a brow. You're sure it wasn't just another member of the press looking to get a foot in the door for an interview?
Positive. This Amy Bregman was as transparent as glass. She not only called, she emailed me her contact information and just about everything else about her, from her birthplace to where she went to school to her new job. Cool company, and an equally cool job, by the way. Anyway, she was talking a mile a minute about fearing for her life.
Did she give you any details?
She was too scared to do that on the phone. She begged me to set up a meeting so she could do that in person. But she did tell me the incident that's prompting all this hysteria. So I double-checked it, along with her background info, obviously, and it all rang true. The incident she's referring to did happen just a little over a day ago. It made the news.
What incident?
Mark asked patiently, trying to bring Emma down a notch. It didn't do much good, although Emma did pause long enough to breathe.
The director of alumni relations at Danforth University disappeared the night before last. The story's just leaking out now, but Amy Bregman was apparently the last person to see the woman and is being questioned by the NYPD. She's convinced there was foul play involved.
Mark's lips twitched.
Foul play? Watching old detective movies, are we?
Mark, I'm serious and...
Emma's right, Casey interrupted. I caught a news article about this disappearance before I left my apartment. The director's name was Rita Edwell. No official report is being released, but insiders are saying the NYPD is investigating and that crime scene was spotted on the campus grounds, which means there's evidence of a crime having been committed, not just a woman who chose to vanish.
Exactly, Emma bobbed her head up and down. And our wannabe client obviously knows something. Trust me, she's really flipping out.
Call her back, Casey replied without hesitation. Set up a meeting for 10. If she's really afraid someone's coming after her, she'll be here in an hour. Tribeca's Kitchen, Church Street, Manhattan, New York. Claire finished the last bite of her avocado and goat cheese omelet and pushed aside her plate. I'm officially stuffed, she said. Not only do I talk more when you and I get together, I also eat more. But the food here is amazing, Fiona replied, sipping at her coffee and eyeing the remaining half of her last blueberry pancake. At least you had a healthy omelet. I just scarfed down thousands of calories of carbs. I'll be running an extra 5 miles today. She tucked strands of her hair behind her ears to keep them safe from the messy syrup she was still using. Her coloring was just like Ryan's, thick black hair, intensely dark blue eyes, and skin tone that looked as if it were perpetually tanned. And even though her features and body type were delicate, while Ryan was solid and masculine, you couldn't miss the family resemblance. Claire smiled. We've talked about everything under the sun, but you never got the chance to tell me about the new jewelry pieces you're working on. A different collection? Actually, yes. Fiona took another bite of her pancake. I've never strayed from Celtic influences before, but for some reason, I had the urge to create something a little different, nature-inspired this time. I'm happily creating leaves and flowers that look sculpted in gold and silver. You saw the technique in my cuff bracelet. The light and shadows collection is still a work in progress, but I'm spending a little time each day on these new pieces. I promise to show them to you as soon as the first few designs are done. I can't wait. As Claire spoke, her phone trilled, telling her she had a text message. She glanced down. Ryan, she reported, clicking into the text. Potentially a new case. I'm being summoned to the office ASAP. She gave Fiona a rueful look as she dabbed at her mouth with her napkin and pulled out her credit card. I'm sorry to cut this short. Fiona waved away the apology and the credit card. Duty calls. Go. This one's on me. We'll do breakfast again soon, and it'll be your turn to pay. She put down her fork. Now I have no excuse. I'm walking home to Soho, changing into my running gear, and sprinting through the neighborhood like a track star to burn off my breakfast. Her eyes twinkled. Give my brother a big hug for me. 3. Offices of Forensic Instincts, Main Conference Room, 2nd Floor, 10 a.m. Casey sat at the head of the expansive mahogany table, around which gathered the entire FI team and their prospective client. Casey sipped her coffee, simultaneously studying Amy Bregman. The young woman was fiddling with her bracelet and gazing around the room with huge eyes. Casey felt bad that she was so nervous. Not long ago, this interview would have been conducted in a smaller, cozier first-floor conference room rather than this far more formidable one. Unfortunately, FI's notoriety had grown to the point where a few phony clients and even one shrewd, scummy blogger had gotten by Emma's clever screening. Casey wasn't about to let that happen again. So even though her gut told her that Amy was in real trouble, she wanted the young woman's guard to be down and for her to feel unsettled enough so Casey could pick up on all her tells and be thoroughly convinced of her sincerity. This conference room was just the place to allow for that. It rivaled that of a Fortune 500 company. Decorated by Casey herself, it boasted polished hardwood floors, a plush oriental rug, and a mahogany credenza that matched the table, and that contained a state-of-the-art Jura professional coffee station and built-in fridge and wine cooler. French doors led to a terrace that overlooked a small but professionally landscaped garden. A gigantic video wall covered the longest side of the room, allowing Ryan to assemble an overwhelming array of information into a large single image or several smaller simultaneous data feeds. Video conferencing equipment, an elaborate phone system, and a personalized virtual workstation at each team member's station at the table completed the decor. And the rest?
Ryan's crucial technology infrastructure was all hidden from view. Amy had been announced at the front door by Yoda, Ryan's almost-human, almost-omniscient AI system, and then escorted by Emma directly to this room. Quick introductions to the accomplished team members, a cup of coffee, and a chair at the table had completed Amy's arrival. The whole experience was enough to intimidate even the savviest visitor, and Amy was far from that. Even though she was in her late 20s, she seemed younger, greener than most women her age. Maybe it was because of the nature of her business, which exposed her mostly to a youthful audience. Or maybe it was just who she was, a small-town girl learning to survive in the Big Apple. In either case, she was definitely awestruck by FI. Physically, she was more put together than pretty, done, as Emma would say. Her makeup carefully applied, her outfit trendy, her layered haircut equally so. Her cool job was an impressive title at a barely legal startup company. True, the company had the potential of blowing it out of the water in terms of success, and it was located in a spot in Elmton that had room for physical expansion, no doubt chosen for that very reason. But right now, it was in its fledgling phase. As marketing director, Amy obviously spent a good chunk of her life either on college campuses or schmoozing influencers who were barely adults. Yes, she was educated and intelligent, but Casey's scrutiny determined that she was far too guileless to be fabricating the situation she was now facing. No, she was every bit as terrified as Emma had described. Time to put her at ease and to get down to the reason for her fear. The team was poised, iPads on and ready, waiting for Casey to take the lead, which she now did. "Start at the beginning and take us through everything, Amy," she said. Amy's gaze snapped over to Casey. "Does that mean you believe me? That you're taking my case?"
"It means we're convinced enough to listen."
Amy hesitated.
"Is everything we discuss confidential, no matter what?"
"As long as you didn't commit a crime, yes. Everything that's said here remains here, regardless of whether or not we end up taking you on as a client."
"Okay."
Amy paused for a second, anxiously gripping her purse and giving Casey a pleading look.
"Your fee,"
she said, looking miserable.
"I'm not sure how high it is. I make a decent salary, but I'm sure it's a far cry from what you charge. Please, I'll give you a credit card, and I'll pay out the full amount with interest."
"Not to worry," Casey waved away that concern. "Our fees fluctuate depending upon so many variables. If we agree to work together, we'll have you sign our standard contract and we'll settle on an estimated range we can all live with." A hint of a smile. "I promise we won't bankrupt you. That's not the way we work." A flash of relief crossed Amy's face, although it did nothing to diminish the haunted look in her eyes or the strain that tightened her expression.
Rita and I were friends,"
she said in a quavering voice.
"I knew her for 10 years.
A wave of compassion swept through Casey as she noted the fact that Amy had said "were," not "are." It was clear she believed her friend was no longer alive. "How did that friendship come about? Rita's a good decade older than you. Did you meet at Danforth? I saw you attended school there."
"She was my mentor. I met her at a college fair when she was in the admissions department, and she guided me ever since."
Amy rested her hands on the table, staring at her fingers as she went on to relay her history with Rita.
"So when I started my job at Canna BD, I naturally turned to her for help and for the best alumni contacts she could recommend."
Casey nodded. "Makes sense. Go on."
"A few days ago, I asked Rita to connect me up with a Danforth alum who's a major influencer. She was really reluctant to do so, but she understood that he could have launched Canna BD big time. He's..."
Amy broke off, twisting her fingers on the table.
"He's famous. We all met for a drink. And what happened there?"
She broke off, tears coming to her eyes. "Famous how?" Casey asked that question first, before getting into the reasons why Rita was unhappy about making the introduction.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.